Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Tonight we're going to talk about reactive programming. We're going to dig into Spring Boot's Webflux Flux class. It is a publisher which publishes data to subscribers. And it has, it's possible to subscribe to the publisher, and it's possible to listen to the next value. It's possible to listen to errors if an exception occurs within the Flux. Then we will then onError will be called on the subscriber. That's also onComplete, so the subscriber knows when is the data stream done. When are we done receiving the data? So what actually happens is that we have a publisher, and this is our Flux. This is called Flux. I'll just write a P for publisher, and then we have a subscriber out here. So the publisher it has a lot of data. Maybe it has some data from a database, which is if it's also a reactive enabled database, then we'll actually get the data one piece at a time. We'll actually get the data one piece at a time whenever it's ready, and this publisher here will then make sure. It might actually map the data to something different or to a new format, to other classes, and then the subscriber actually subscribes to this publisher right here. And there needs to be at least one subscriber for the publisher to work. And this, because the default publisher is a cold publisher. So if you use the Flux, then it's a cold publisher you're using. That means there needs to be at least one subscriber for the code to be called, and that means that there will be only published. The data will be published if there's at least one subscriber. Then publish the data. It comes like here, like pearls on a string. If you're dealing with a hot publisher, which is not very common, it's very unusual. If a hot publisher, then even though that there will be no subscriber, then data will still be published. There will just be no one listening to it, and it means that and it does a difference sometimes. It makes a difference sometimes, and that is when codes states are being changed inside, for instance, the publisher, when maybe it maps to something different and then also changes mistakes, then this will not be executed when it's a cold publisher. If there are multiple subscribers, then for each subscriber the same data set will then be delivered, or actually a new instance of the data. Even though it's the exact same data, then the data will be produced once again for this new subscriber and also the new subscriber again here. So that means that for each subscriber, the data that the publisher needs to publish will be created and published. But that is the theory. Let us dig right into it and see a practical example with the Flux. So a Flux, that is the class that actually represents a publisher in Spring Web Flux. It's actually just a promise that there will be some data sometimes in the future. I have this project here that I used the other evening when we started dealing with the Spring Boot Reactive. I'm going down to my test folder right here, into the Java folder and into this package right here. Then we're going to create a new package because we are going to play with unit tests tonight. So I'm going to create a new package right here. We can call this Flux Tests. Or just Flux. Let's just call Flux. So we will play around with the Flux here. There are actually a lot of classes that can help us with testing our Fluxes and our web clients. I'll not dig into this tonight. I'll create a separate video or separate videos about that. So tonight we're going to use some ugly tricks like thread sleep to make everything work as expected. So let me just create a Flux right here. I'm calling this Flux test. Let me call this cold Flux test. And I would like to avoid the Spring context just because it takes some time. So I'll actually create a local class down in my test right here that actually creates a Flux. And I have prepared a Flux. It looks a bit like the Flux that we used the other day. I'll create a Flux of spaceships. So right here, this is my method right here. I have a class called spaceship, and this spaceship, I'll just go look at it so you can all see how it looks. First, I need to import it. Yes. Import the Flux, import the duration from the Java time package. So let us go to our spaceship I hold control and then I press the spaceship. This is the class that we created the other evening. I have we annotated with lumbok data, no args constructor, all args constructor, just so then it's easier to create spaceships. Then it has two member variables, two fields. One is name and the other one is crew. So it's a kind of, it's quite simple class. So I'm creating a flux right here. That means that this is a promise that a data will come at some point, or it, you could also call it a publisher actually. And we create this by just, there's a constructor, there's a method, there's a static method called flux just, and then we can actually add all the values one by one, or the objects one by one that we want to have in this flux right here. And then at the end, I'm telling it to delay each element for 3 seconds just to simulate that there's some kind of delay. Maybe we are picking this up from a third party vendor or from a database. I could have created this another way, and that would be by using it with an iterator. So if I had a list, like a list of and then all these spaceships right here. Let me just create this list right here, introduce a new list. So let's say you have a list of spaceships, then I can actually just add the spaceships right here. So it also takes an iterator. Just iterate. Oh, let me just go down here again. From iterable instead. So instead of calling just, then I can call from iterable, and then I can give it my list of spaceships right here, and then it's actually the same. So now I have a list of spaceships. Maybe it's a bit easier to understand. And then we have a flux which relies on this list here, and we delay each element 3 seconds. Let us try to test this. So now I want to run the test. We will have a void test the flux, and in here I would like to subscribe to this flux that we actually get. So flux, first we execute the call, we call a flux, and we assign this to a local variable called my flux, and then I can subscribe to this flux in several ways. One way is just to call subscribe and then have a lot of lambdas. We can have 3 lambdas, one for what should happen when we get the next value, what should happen if we get an error, and what should happen if when we are done. So I'll just implement all these three with lambdas to begin with, just to see how easy it is. If I do it with lambdas, then I will have a lambda that actually takes a ship as an argument. So that means we have the ship right here. Then I can write something like system out print line, and then I can write ship from flux, and then percentage s, then I'm going to format, and then IntelliJ will help me switch around the string format like this. Let me just create this on a new line, because we are getting 3 lambdas, so it will be a bit difficult to keep track of in the end. So this was the first lambda. Then we're going to create a new lambda. Oh, it is done right there. So this is the second lambda. This is on error. So this is if an error happens, what should we do with it, with the error? So that means we are actually subscribing to we are subscribing to the flux, of course, but we are setting a lambda for what should happen when we get the error. All right, error right here. It's actually an exception. So then again, I can just system out. Now I'll steal this line up here, copy, and then we'll say some error occurred, and percentage s again, and then I'll take the error, and then I'll call get message, could also be get course. Now I'm shading for this code right here, so I'll just scroll down a bit. Error get message, and then the last thing we need to create, and the last lambda, that is for when we are done. So this means complete. Now we are complete, and then we just write system out print line, and then we say run right yes, we are done. And this will not happen if an error occurs in the midway. Actually, we are not getting anything right here, so this is actually an empty lambda. There's no arguments for this for the complete lambda right here, onComplete event. So now I'm actually subscribing to this flux right here. And as soon as I subscribe to the Flux, that means that then we will actually start providing data to our subscriber. And this is our subscriber actually right here. If I don't do anything, then nothing will actually happen. I need to because when the test ends right here, then it will actually kill all the threads which were created in the test. And I mean, so then also the thread where the flux is publishing data to the subscriber, that will also end. So I'll just add a sound right here, so we can say test begin. And I'll duplicate the with Control D, and then I'll say test end right here, and then we can actually see that it just ends and nothing actually happens to begin with. Let me just run the test right here. I will press run the unit test. And then what I will add tonight is that I will just add a thread sleep in the bottom right here with like 10 seconds or something like that. So we can see all the values, or maybe a little bit more, 2, 4, 5. So maybe like 20 seconds. Okay, now we have a green test right here. Nothing actually happened because we just have a test begin and test end, because it takes 3 seconds before we will get the first element. Let me add a sleep thread dot sleep. This is not the right way to do it. I'll just say that again, just to make sure. I'll create another video of how actually to test your fluxes. There's a whole library for doing that, which is much better than this. This method, this is just for learning how to subscribe to a flux. Usually we would not subscribe to fluxes in tests. We would actually subscribe to fluxes when we call third party services, or maybe databases, or maybe we call some if we call some file IO, then if you do some file IO, then we will also use fluxes, for instance. So usually all the subscriptions will actually be up in the in real code, not down in the test source. We can see here now in output that here's all my ship from Flux, Hawk, and the crew. That is really, really good. I would like an error to occur actually, and here we can actually see, yes, we are done. So this is the completion. This is a completion method, lambda, which is being executed right here. So this is on completion. Yes, we are done. I would like an error to be thrown actually, so we can see that the error lambda is being invoked. So, and I can do that by mapping the data. There are several ways of doing this, but one way is actually to map the data to something else. When I have the flux right here, then I can map, and then I can say ship, and then I can map it to something else. And then I can write some code right here, and then I can say if spaceships dot get name, or get dot spaceship dot, oh, spaceship, oh, it's actually just ship, sorry, ship dot get name. If the name equals, and then round, then we throw an exception, throw new runtime exception. The ship is round. So this is just now we will not get down to the completion, we will not get down to the onComplete lambda, which is right here. We should end in the error. Let us just see what we need to. Okay, we need to return a ship right here. Can return the same ship. I could also have done something. I could actually have set the crew to ship.getCrew. Like I could multiply the crew members by 2 or something like that. That is what the mapping is for. That's actually to map the data to the format that that we need in this situation here. So maybe we'll get this flux from a third party vendor, and then then we just map it to something different, and then we pass it on to actually invokes our service. Let us try to run the test now, see what happens. So, oh. Oh, we actually got the error here. Whoopsie, some error occurred. The ship is round. So I would actually have expected. Let me write just instead right here. Just see if it does a difference. I would have expected actually, or first I would have expected the onNext for all of these spaceships right here. Let's just see what happens now. So now we have the spaceships right there, and then we map it, and then we get an error. If the name is round, then we throw that spaceship. We can also, let us try to print it out, actually format, and then hit the ship right there. Then we have percentage S, so that we have the spring, the ship represented right, represented right there, and then let us try again. See if it does if there's any changes right now. If it, yeah. Okay, it actually passes up right away. So, and then it sees, okay, there's one ship, round crew 30, and that actually gives us an error. So instead of actually giving us all of the ships one by one, then it actually throws the error right away when we add the map right there. I'll just try to set it here. Let's see if I see a difference. Yeah, so now they come one by, because it depends on which order I'm doing stuff in. So first now I'm delaying it, and then after delaying it, then I'm actually mapping one ship at a time to something else. So, and then we can see first we get on next. This is one ship. And we can actually also see that the mapping works, because we have 20 crew members on the Hawk. That we start with only having 10 crew members, and then we multiply by 2 down here. So it actually worked, and then we come down to after the Swan, then we go come to the round spaceship, and then we say in our mapping, if the name was round, then we are throwing a runtime exception. And then down in our subscription down here in our subscriber, then we have our error handler right here, and this it then catches it, and then we say whoopsie, some error occurred, this ship is round, and then and then we're done after that. Then no more data is published to us. I really hope that this made sense of how to subscribe to a Flux. There is another way. If you don't like lambdas, then there's actually a class called base subscriber. Let's try to use that instead. So I'll create a new class right here. My spaceship. Another way, instead of using these lambdas, then we can create, we can extend the base subscriber instead, and then subscribe by using an old-fashioned Java class instead. So let's say I create the spaceship subscriber like this, base subscriber, and then I will extend. I need to give this a generic type also. This is a spaceship type. And I'm extends base subscriber, and this I'm also giving this the type spaceship like this, and control O to override. Then you can see here we have something called hook on next, hook on subscribe, hook on complete, hook on error. We can also check on cancel, but we're not going to cancel it. Okay, I'm going to add it anyway. And then I press OK. Then IntelliJ will actually create an override method for each of these right here. Hook on subscribe. What we want to do, we need to request a new element right here. So that means that we can actually, first we can system out something. And then after that, then we request another element from the Flux. So we can say subscribed. And then we can print out the representation of the subscription. There's actually the subscription right here. Is there anything interesting there? No, I don't think so. So, but so we're just we're just printing out the string representation of the subscription, and then when we come down to hook on next, then we'll write next element, next spaceship, and then we can write the value like this. This is the spaceship, and then we need to request a new one. So we'll write request one more. And hook on complete, let us add system output also here. Completed. And we don't need the string format right here. There's nothing to print out. It's just it's just a ping that now we are completed. Then we have hook on error. Let us fill this one out because we are going to create an error. Error occurred. And let me say throwable. Dot get message. On cancel, this is not, we're not going to play with this tonight, but I'm going to implement it anyway. So canceled. And we don't need to format that. So then now I have my own spaceship subscriber, which extends base subscriber, and we are writing all these methods right here. And whenever we get the subscribe event, then we request the next element. And when we get the next element, then we request one more element. So that is how it works. That means that now I can go to my test right here, and here where I subscribe with my lambdas, then I can, instead of that, I'll just I'll comment this. Then I will subscribe with the spaceship subscriber instead, like this. Yes, let's try this and play. Subscribed, next element. Next element. Some point then we come to the round one and then we get the exception. Oh, error occurred. Ship is round. Spaceship round. Blah, blah, blah. And then we're actually done. So then nothing more happens after that. The complete is not being invoked because an error occurred, so we never completed the flux. Yeah. Let us try to have two subscribers. Let's see what happens. Next element. Yeah, so that was just to show we can have multiple subscribers without any problem. That's one of the ideas about a Flux and a publisher. So that's actually it. I hope you liked this video. Or else, just leave me comments if there's something else you want me to show. Have a great evening, and I hope to see you again soon. Bye-bye.